I'm sitting up a little higher than usual because my fat self broke the chair that I was sitting in that was over here in my corner of the world. In fact, I had the neck brace. I had the neck brace on a little earlier, and my voice is kind of going on its way out today. I'm faring well, and I appreciate the prayers of all of you that have been praying for me. Question came up on Twitter not too long ago, but I've been having trouble with Twitter lately. Not that I'm on it a lot, but I'm trying to get better and utilize it as a communication tool. And as soon as I decided to do that, I'm having trouble actually communicating with it. It's like freezing up. I don't know. At any rate, someone asked, what is a recommendation for a leadership manual? And my immediate response was this: A Christian Behavior by John Bunyan. Now, here's a paperback edition that I've edited in modern English. I did the edition in modern English in Alaska while we were still in Scammon Bay. The reason why I did so is to make it accessible for the men that were there. It's good for anyone to read, man or woman, but it is a good leadership manual. In fact, the blessed truth of it is such that though it is outlined and it's wonderful because it is short. It was written this way to be short because many were writing bodies of divinity on how you're to act as a Christian believer that was voluminous, thousands of pages long, something that most people couldn't afford in the day of Mr. Bunyan. And so he wrote this treatise, very small, easy to carry around, easy to refer to as a practical application of the scriptures. But notice that the practical application in Christian behavior is basically behavior that should become all saints. And this is the thing. This is what real Christian leadership is about. It's not that the leaders are higher than the others or placed upon a pedestal, that because one is a pastor, an elder, or a deacon, that they're put in a place of particular separation. They're no different. What we believe as Baptists, and part of our Baptist history is that that we're congregational within that regard. Though I exercise my particular gifts of preaching and teaching and exercising leadership within the polity of the congregation, in that sense, I'm no different from any other member of the congregation. But see, Christian behavior is also that way. In his blessed treatise that provides the very practical aspects of it, Mr. Bunyan points out very importantly four particular truths that must be adhered to, or principles of truth that are adhered to in understanding our behavior as Christians, that it must be applied by faith. And the first thing he says, that good works flow from faith. The second thing is that everyone that believes should be careful that their works are good. The third thing is that every believer should not only be careful that their works are good and for the present do them, but should also be careful to maintain them. That is, keep, that they should endeavor diligently to keep in the constant course of good works. And the way that he writes that is such that once, as you go through and understand this, as he expresses it, that the good works every single time in each one of these points, it springs forth from faith. What is that? The gospel. It springs forth from the truth of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And then the fourth thing, and lastly, that the best way to provoke both ourselves and others to this work is to often affirm to others the doctrine of justification by grace, which is where we get the name of my personal ministry website, justification by grace, and to believe it ourselves, as he does quote from Titus, as he quotes from Titus chapter 3 right there. See, Timothy chapter 3 and Titus chapter 1 as elements of that which present leadership, the offices of the bishop and the deacon, are not to be such that they are a legalistic approach to who our leaders are. They still spring forth from the same faith, as all of us are redeemed by God's grace through faith. It is the truth of Jesus Christ and Him crucified, and therefore those who have a particular calling within their redemption, within their salvation as a personal possession, then they will most certainly have guidelines and principles of truth as such that spring forth from, and they are accomplished through the truth that I am redeemed by God's grace, and since this is my calling, not in the legalism that says, well, this one can't be because, well, he drinks a little bit of wine, and he shouldn't drink wine as a pastor because it says that pastors are not given the wine, and the deacons are not given the much wine. So see, there's a distinction, but that doesn't make sense because the pastor that Paul had written to in that very epistle, Timothy, the pastor of the church, three chapters later, he said, do not drink any longer water, but drink wine for your stomach, for your many infirmities. So does it mean that you can't drink wine when he would contradict himself? No, we see it as the principles of truth to understand that whatever behavior we have springs forth from the truth of the gospel. We see things through the precious blood of Jesus Christ. We see things through the redemption and the atoning death of Jesus Christ. We see things through the righteousness of Christ, which is exalted, and not my behavior to be exalted. It's never that, because the best of my behavior, if I could externally do all these things that are presented in the scriptures in order to walk around as someone who is pious in the view of others, it'll never, ever, ever, even by the grace of God that it is allowed to be seen by others, it'll never come close to the righteousness and impeccable sinlessness of Jesus Christ. He is the only righteous man, and it is upon His righteousness that has saved us, and therefore it is His righteousness that we look unto in all things. We don't take our eyes off it for a second to say, well, you know, it's righteous, let's move on. His righteousness is the brilliance of the glory of God in its illumination. We don't remove our eyes from that glory, except to cover it because it's too overwhelming. Cover it in the sense of what I say is as the seraphim hovering over the very throne of God in Christ, as we see that picture in Isaiah chapter 6, that they had six wings, with two they did fly, so that they couldn't even light upon the holiness of even the floor, as it were, of the throne room of God, because it was so holy that they did fly. With two wings they did cover their feet, so as not to have that thing, and which is common for travel, to be even a thing to insult the Lord, that they should show Him the soles of their feet. And as it is written, you know, that when Moses approached the bush that was burning but that was not consumed, take the shoes off of thy feet, for the ground that you stand upon is holy ground. And with two wings they did cover their face, so it's not that Christ's brilliance couldn't come through, but the brilliance that did come through, that they as created beings would cover their face so as not to even dishonor the Lord, as if to look upon them. See, these are the perspectives that the cross bring unto us, and they're very lofty indeed, hard to get a hold of. They are from the very throne of God and are infinite and eternal. So don't think I'm saying things that are so high that I'm shooting them over your head. They are high and they're over all of our heads. The next thing was, this is just to finish this off, I know I'm going on too long and I shouldn't, I need to save my voice, and I might need to put my neck brace on again, but another thing that went along with that is I've had a couple people ask me about, well, do you think I would benefit from seminary, or do you think I should just give myself over onto a different curriculum within the local church? And my answer is yes. If the Lord is bringing you to a place where you have the wherewithal, the financial ability to be able to go into seminary, it wouldn't be for naught. I personally would lean against most of them. There is a resurgence of the doctrines of grace and many other wonderful truths that expound the glories of Christ and Him crucified at our institutions of biblical learning now. But they still have a long way to go. And because the resurgence is among the young and the youthful, it's not tempered with a seasoning of great sage maturity. That's the problem. Not that the professors aren't sage and mature; they are, but it's academic, and it is apart from the truth of the local church and its importance in the lives of believers. I would rather see I would actually rather see if a young person who has received the call upon their life and they're just not getting fed because the truth of Christ and Him crucified, the sum of the gospel is not preached in their congregation, but somehow God has got a hold of this life, then yeah, get off to a seminary. But if there is a church where you have a pastor, regardless of the size of it, and if he's preaching Christ crucified and compromised, then more than likely it's a small congregation, and it might be hurtful for even one person to leave. And so I suggest stay there. There are venues that are available and resources like Ecclesia Theological Seminary, and though I would love for our church to be a part of that, we're not yet. We're too small in number. And do not have the time or there are many elements, I should say, that do not allow us to be more fully impacted and part of what is put together by Johnny White down in Pensacola. Jeff Pollard is his pastor, and I strongly recommend that, and I applaud what they are doing by having the biblical education being placed into the local church with the elders and leaders that are within that local church, so that that leaders can grow from that local church. The reason why this is things like that are important is because it keeps it within the local church, and if the preacher is one who is preaching Christ and Him crucified, there is this that will increase his preaching by having one who is prayerfully knit with Him in His growing in grace and being strengthened in faith, and so that you have that mutuality of the one who is learning altogether with the one who is providing guidance as a leader and pastoral ministry unto one who has that call upon him. If ecclesia isn't a possibility at this point within that, that's still all right. What you can do, and here are some recommendations, if you have a call upon your life, and you can do this even if you're going to go to seminary, I recommend that you do this. You take your statement of faith from your church. Is it the 1689 London Baptist Confession? Is it the 1742 Philadelphia Confession? And you take that as a systematic theology, and then you write down with the scripture references why these things are so and why you believe them and hold to them. Or if you don't, for example, there might be something in there and says, you know, I'm not altogether with this. Here are the scripture references it provides, but it's not settled in my soul. you will want to do that. You'll get more theology out of doing that than many of the other things. You want to memorize your catechism like we use in our congregation and in our homes. We encourage the recitation daily of a Puritan's catechism, and we do so on our Sunday mornings, a portion of it, of the catechism that Mr. Spurgeon had published in 1855 for the use in their congregation. There is also Robert Murray McShane's reading plan. If you have a call upon your life to the pastoral ministry, it is more important than reading anything else that you know the scriptures and that you read them. And because there are four portions that are offered if you get together with your pastor and whatever reading plan that your congregation is using, use that one. Ours recommends the use of the Robert Murray McShane reading portion. There are four portions there to be used for the family and for personal private devotion, and I recommend that one. But whichever one your congregation is using, be a part of that congregation and be useful and helpful for wherever the sheep in that congregation are feeding. You should be feeding there too, as long as it's one that provides that you can read through the Bible at least in a year and as many times as possible. The other two resources that I would recommend, I've recommended Christian Behavior, but moreover, I recommend the Complete Works of John Bunyan. And you may not agree with everything that he has written, however, you will gain more from reading the Complete Works of John Bunyan, including the allegories, Solomon's Temple Spiritualized, the Holy War, and that favorite book of mine, The Pilgrim's Progress. You will get more from reading, all of the treatises of John Bunyan, not just the allegories, but you'll get more from reading those. As Mr. Spurgeon said, prick him anywhere and you'll find that his blood is bibline. He cannot but speak without quoting scripture. It was that much a part of his life. And for his 12 years of imprisonment in the Bedford jail, he was armed only with the Bible and Fox's Book of Martyrs. And so the words that come forth from that man to me are greater than what I could learn in any class that I'm sitting in. And also read everything that you can from Mr. Spurgeon, Charles Spurgeon. If you did those things, I guarantee you, I promise you this, from the bottom of my heart, I believe this to be so, that you will fare better as a pastor and you will minister much more greatly as a preacher than 8 years in seminary and then kind of coming out and stumbling out and trying to figure out where your bearings are. If you're coming alongside and a pastor who is passionate for the preaching of Christ and Him crucified, you're in a congregation that is desirous to be a congregation with the illumination of the light of the gospel truth, then why leave that environment in order to get your education to preach? You will be ministered to by the Spirit of Christ for those things, and He will be your supply. And He will be glorified rather than the truth of the delicate grace of Jesus Christ upon you rather than the degrees you get upon your wall. Let it be the decree of God in Christ to call you unto your leadership position and place you there rather than the degree that you earn through much study in an institution. Those things aren't bad, and there are many men who have tremendous education and learning whom I admire, I respect, and I applaud as men who are steadfast to the gospel and have their place in the work of Christ in the kingdom of heaven. But I strongly have an urgency to encourage things that minister unto the truth of the local congregation. So important, the local congregation, and that local congregation bringing glory to God the Father through the exaltation of the Son among a people that are committed to Christ, and as committed to Christ, are committed to one another in those truths. So I thank you for listening. I hope I haven't rambled on too much. I know I said a lot, in a short time, but that's the great thing of video, that you can play it back, and hopefully I haven't missed out on anything. But I'm firmly convinced on those things. The Bible, Mr. Bunyan, the Prince of Preachers, get your confession of faith, your catechism, and you will fare well as a preacher. So fare thee well. Remember, he paid a debt he did not owe. You owe a debt you couldn't pay. Christ and Him crucified is the sum of the gospel. Thanks for watching.